Glad to see each and every one of you here, whether you join us in person or online. I'd just like to remind everybody who is in person to silence your cell phones. I hope I did that. Maybe you can ask Nicole if I did it. What did she get today? We're going to start with a couple songs. I invite you to stand and sing along.
Divided. Oh, Jesus, Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning.
What's the matter, Diane? You hot again?
Always.
Always hot. Okay. It is, it was Serenity's birthday, and she is not here today, so we won't be singing to her, but I haven't forgot. And we won't be here next Sunday, and neither will Serenity, because we'll both be camping, but we're going to hit her in 2 weeks.
How old is Serenity?
She is 14. 14 years old. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. And they just came back from camp on Friday, Jack, Raylan, and Serenity. And Cameron and Jersey are still up there. And we'll pick those up on, these kids up on Friday, this coming Friday. And controversy follows everywhere. So, little to-dos up there at the camp. So, never without any things, some things going wrong. And but God is good all the time. All the time. He takes care of things. So, all right, let's go to the Lord in prayer and get things going here. Good morning, God. It's us here at Waterford Cathedral. And Father, we're so very, very, very appreciative of your presence this morning in our service. And you're sitting here with each and every one of us and at home with the people that are online. And Father, we know that that we're going to get a blessing out of what's going on in this building today. And Father, I pray that there are some problems out there, and we'll be with Spring Hill Camps. Be with each one of those counselors as they have problems to deal with kids, because every, you know, Father, that every one of us are broken in a certain way. And Father, it just seems to pop out in the weirdest times or the wildest ways. And Father, I also pray that those who are sick among us, like Lori Shaneman, Helen's with her right now, being her caregiver.
Yes.
Be with Helen as she tends to Lori, and Father, we pray for a complete recovery for Lori. And Father, also be with Marilyn and their hip or leg or whatever is wrong with her. Father, we know that you know what the problem is, and reach down and heal her, or be with the doctors as they examine and take care of her, Father. And there are so many others out there, Father, and that we know that you are the ultimate healer on things like this. And Father, I pray that you be with the service. May Jason sing the songs that you want him to sing this morning, and be with the pastor this morning as he does our message. May it be the words that we need to hear for this particular week that's coming up, or for this particular day. So we ask all these things in your precious and loving name. Amen.
You know, typically as I'm picking music, try to change the tempos a little bit and give you something a little bit different. But we got a lot of praise ballads today, so I invite you to stand. We're going to sing a couple more. Sometimes it just works out that way.
All creation I sing praise. Thank you. For 6,000 years, Christ's bride has been waiting and watching, hoping against hope, enduring persecution, and clinging to the promise he left her with, "I will come for you." She was there in Genesis 4 when men first began to call upon the name of the Lord. She obediently weathered the storm in Noah's ark. We find her trusting in her beloved when Joseph said, "Do not leave my bones in Egypt." She laughed with Sarah, wept with Abraham, and raised the knife over little Isaac. The bride of Christ was seen crossing the Red Sea. By faith, she subdued kings and kingdoms. She relentlessly cried after the wayward to repent, called down fire from heaven, and thwarted the fiery furnace of the wicked. In love sonnets to the Rose of Sharon, we find her to be sick of love. But she was there patiently awaiting her groom when a virgin conceived, and a man cried in the wilderness, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord." She momentarily rejoiced in the brief visit from her beloved, but wept bitterly when he left her to wait a little longer. Over the years, the forces of evil have laughed her to scorn, tortured her, mocked her, and scattered her abroad. She has suffered infiltration and subversion, frontal assaults and assaults from within, yet she still clings to hope, trusting in the return of her spouse. She studies the words he left her with, to know his heart a little more every day. Her faith never wavers. She is opposed on every side, yet not distressed, perplexed, but not in despair. When he finally returns for her, our Lord will find her with her lamp trimmed, with her eyes watching, and with her garments inexplicably whiter than snow. In the meantime, she comforts herself at the local assembly. Nothing is sweeter than the communion of the saints, building each other up in edification and love, affirming their stand upon the foundation of God's word. How good and how blessed it is for brethren to dwell together in unity, to share in the fellowship of Christ's sufferings, caring for each other according to our gifts as members one of another. But woe to those whose place it is to watch out for the bride, yet instead set themselves up as a substitute for her beloved. Woe to those who abuse her, deign to control her, and interject themselves over her in place of the groom. Christ is head of the church. There is no other. Watchmen, God has entrusted you with a solemn duty. Feed the flock, but remember, they are not yours. Lift up your voice, blow the trumpet, watch for their souls, but don't touch the bride. Christ is her authority, and she remains submitted to him. Our Lord delayeth not his coming. He that hath the bride is the groom, who purchased her with his own blood. Christ's universal church is the pillar and ground of the truth. In spite of local compromises and defeats, she marches on, victorious over all the earth throughout the ages. The gates of hell are powerless to stop her, and as she nears the day of her wedding, her groom continues to give her the gifts she needs to be purified and perfected. She is called out. She is spiritually assembled in heavenly places. She is physically assembled in local churches. She is built on the prophets and apostles, yet her head and cornerstone, as in all churches of the saints, is Jesus Christ.
Part of the bride this morning. Amen. Aren't you excited that he continually is cleansing you and I through the water of the washing of the word, so that he may present us back to himself as a glorious bride, without spot and without wrinkle. Isn't that good news? Because each and every day, if we look at ourselves in the mirror, we see a lot of spots and we see a lot of wrinkles, do we not? And yet He is cleansing you and I. He is doing what He said, making us one with Himself. Amen. And in that oneness, there's a holiness, there's a purity, and there is a love that passes all understanding, passes all comprehension, passes all ability for you and I to be able to wrap our finite minds around what God has done, what He is doing, and what He will finish, which He began. Amen. Isn't that the greatest of all promises?
Amen.
That I will finish the work that I began in you. If He's began a work in you, and I know He has, then we can rest in the promise. He's going to finish the work. And He'll break down whatever resistance inside of you and I there is that hinders the progress of that work. Amen. Because He will not be stopped. He will not be delayed. He will accomplish everything that He set forth to do. Amen. And I'm so glad this morning that we have the opportunity to be His bride here on the earth, representing Him, loving Him as our husbandman, loving Him as our Savior and our Lord, and following Him throughout all of the trials and the tribulations of our sojourn here through this world, this present earth in which we find ourselves dwelling. We've been in the midst of this series that's called Kingdom Dynamics, as we're learning about how that the dynamics of the kingdoms work. As John Eldridge in one of his books put it, A Mountain Moving Prayer, there is a way that things work, which highly suggests that there's a way that they don't. And so we've been looking specifically into Genesis 24 now for a few weeks, looking at the establishment of the covenant of marriage, which is the foundation of all truth and all principles within the kingdom of God. We are His bride. We are betrothed unto one husbandman. And He established the very covenant of marriage as the foundation of society and as the foundation of His church, which He said, I will build, and the gates of hell will not prevail against my church. Amen. And so we can rest in His promise that He is keeping all of the enemies at bay. That you and I have to renounce any claim that we've allowed the enemy to have on our own lives because of sin in our lives. We have to renounce any claim the enemy's been able to stake upon our churches because we've done things wrong, or we've dishonored our Lord in any way, or we've treated His servants wrong in any way. We have to renounce any claim that the enemy has tried to stake upon the church, because it's the enemy's desire to bring dishonor and to bring shame to the name of Jesus Christ. But thank God that's not your desire, and that's not His purpose in making us His bride. Amen. As His bride, we're bringing all honor and glory to Him and to Him alone. Amen. To God be all the glory. Amen. And if we can keep our focus upon those things and follow the small, still voice, then He will lead us to victory in every aspect of the word. Amen. And then we can rejoice in that victory. Last week we looked at, in the story from Genesis 24, how that through Abraham's most trusted servant, that he had sent him forth to observe a proper bride for his son Isaac. And as he got to a well of water back in his own territory, in his brother Nahor's place, then he found one of his Nahor's great-granddaughters, Rebekah, coming to the well. And the trusted servant of Abraham had observed her and watched how that she went about her daily activities and went about fulfilling the fleece that he had asked of God to have the one who would give him not only a drink of water, but then would say that I will water your camels own also, and watch the way that she joyfully then drew out 400 gallons of water from the well in order to water the 10 camels loaded down with all of the belongings of his master Abraham that he had brought along with him to be able to bless her and to be able to bless the family for the bride price of being able to have Rebecca as the bride for his son Isaac. And we looked at how that that's a similar story of how that the Holy Spirit has been choosing out the bride for Christ. We've been chosen for salvation. We've been chosen to be a part of the bride. We've been sanctified through the precious blood of the Lamb. And we've been washed through the washing of the water of the Word. And we are being presented back to Him as a bride who's worthy of her husbandman, who's worthy of becoming one with the King of Kings and with the Lord of Lords. Amen? And what a great honor and a privilege that is. This week, in the same passages of Scripture in Genesis 24, we're going to look at how important it is that when we're dating, how important it is that when we are looking for a spouse for our lives, that first of all, that we would trust in the Lord to choose the spouse for us, and that then we would do the things that the Lord puts it upon our hearts to do in order for Him to point out to us and assure us and confirm to us that this is the one that He has chosen so that we can become one with one another and bring honor and glory to our Father through the oneness in marriage that He meant to be in place as the foundation of society and as the foundation of His church Himself. In fact, Jesus made it so clear in the Word that if a man is not able to run his own household, there's no way he can run the church of the living God, because the church is His bride. So if he can't love his bride, and he can't love his family, if he can't take care of his wife, and if he can't take care of his family, he's not worthy to lead the church of God. Amen? And those are the qualifications spelled out clearly for all leaders within the church, which is the bride of Jesus Christ. Amen? Whether they be pastors, whether they be teachers, whether they be deacons in the church, elders in the church, or whatever else it may be, there are certain qualifications that they must meet in order to be qualified to lead. Amen? And we do need to be qualified to lead. We learned this morning in the message where we were at that we also need the blessing of God. God blessed them and told them to go forth and be fruitful and to be multiplied. But they didn't have the ability to be fruitful or multiply until they had received the blessing of God. I think that's something for us here at Waterford Baptist Cathedral. I think that because of some past things that have gone on here, we need to spend some time on our knees and be just like Jacob, who said, "I will not let you go till you bless us." Because we cannot grow, we cannot be fruitful, we cannot multiply until we have your blessing, Lord. And if we have done anything that has caused that blessing to be withdrawn, then we need to reestablish the blessing of God upon this place. Amen? And renounce any claim that the enemy has been able to stake upon this place because of something that we've done in the past. Amen? That's a word from the Lord this morning. Amen? In Genesis 24, as we continue in the story, I just want to bring forth the foundational scripture upon which we've been basing all of this upon in Genesis 24:1. It says that now Abraham was old. And I'm getting that because I'm getting older all the time. And now at 65 years old, I realize I don't have the breath I once had. I don't have the strength of the energy that I once had. And I find that when I get out and I work in the ditch lines or I do something in the backyard or taking care of things around, that I run out of gas rather quickly. And if you haven't realized those things yet, then they're coming for you as well. Amen. But Abraham was old and well advanced in age. And so he began to be worried. God made a promise to me that through my seed that all of the nations of the world would be blessed. And here I have seed. I have Isaac, my son, but he has no wife. In fact, he's 40 years old and he still doesn't have a wife. I don't think he knows how to talk to women, Lord. I don't think he knows how to date. I don't even think he knows what to do, or he's been so wrapped up with himself that he's not interested in women, right? But he also is 40 years old, and 40 years seems to be the time of preparation for God for just about everything, amen? If you're going to be prepared for something, it seems like 40 years is how long it takes to prepare you and I to be used of God for His honor and glory. So in that right, I think I've only been good for about 25 years. So I still only got 25 years in me, right? Instead of all of the years that I do. But Abraham was old, advanced in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. You see that word again? The Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. So Abraham said to his oldest servant of his house who ruled over all that he had, "Please put your hand under my thigh, and I will make you swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of earth, that you will not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell. But you shall go to my country and to my family and to take a wife for my son Isaac." Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that your word will endure forever. Heaven and earth is one day going to pass away, but your word will endure forever. The very words which you have spoken and called all things forth into existence are the very words that will judge us all. Father, I thank you that your word is fulfilled through the two simple commands that you gave to us, to love you with all of our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength, and to love others as we love ourselves. Thank you that you fulfilled all things so that in you all of your word is fulfilled. And we are in Christ and Christ is in us. And we thank you for that. We thank you for the plan of salvation. We thank you for the process of salvation. And we thank you for the finished work of salvation one day. And now, Father, we ask that you would place your words in my mouth and help me to bring forth that which you have planted inside of me. And let it become a seed of faith in the lives of each and every person within the hearing of our voice today, Lord God, that the seed of your word might find a lodging place in the soil of their heart and bring forth in them all that you have desired and all that would bring honor and glory to your name. And this we ask in the blessed name of Jesus. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Last week, we looked at how that the servant had offered up a prayer to God as he sat by the well of water. And in that prayer, he gave a fleece. And I just want to bring forth a few passages of Scripture in support of that as an introduction into today's message. In John 15:7, it simply says, "If," that's a big word, isn't it? If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you.
Amen.
There's no doubt in that passage of Scripture. There's no ifs or maybes or qualifications. If you abide in me, and my word abides in you, you shall receive. Right? "Hitherto had ye asked nothing in my name. Asking you shall receive, that your joy may be full," in John 16:4. We've been learning about this in prayer on Wednesday nights, amen? And in Isaiah 65:24, "And it shall come to pass that before they call, that I will answer. And while they are yet speaking," or "while they are yet praying, I will hear." Isn't that exactly what happened to Abraham's servant? While he was still praying, lo and behold, Rebekah was coming forth. He hadn't even finished the prayer yet, and his answer was already coming forth. Amen? How many times have you prayed, and the answer's coming before you ever lift your eyes and say amen? God is already answering the prayer, because that's His promise. And every promise is yes and amen in Jesus Christ. His answer is yes, and And our answer is, amen. Let it be unto me according to your word, Lord. That's faith, right? Believing simply what he said. Point number one in the story this week, if you like points, ask good questions. You've heard me say this ever since I've been here. Ask good questions and you'll get good answers. Ask no questions and you'll get no answers. God is not offended by your questions. God, in fact, encourages your questions because he wants to answer you. Amen? He doesn't want you to be in the dark. He doesn't want you to be without. He doesn't want you to not know. He wants you to know, but he has established asking as the way of giving you what you've asked for. So if you don't ask, you don't receive. Pretty simple process, isn't it? Those are Kingdom Dynamics 101. Ask and you will receive. Ask, don't ask and you won't. It's that simple, right? And so it was in verse 22 of chapter 24. And so it was when the camels had finished drinking, after Rebekah had drawn the 400 gallons of water and had watered all of the servants' camels, that the man took a golden nose ring weighing half of a shekel and two bracelets for her wrists weighing 10 shekels of gold. I don't think you understand the value of these things, right? The nose ring and the bracelets was the kind of jewelry they wore in those days. Today it might be a necklace, it might be a watch, it might be something else because we wear different kinds of jewelry in different ages of time, right? But in that time, nose ring was a common thing. Unbeknownst to me or even to my disgrace sometimes, a nose ring is becoming popular again today, right? I'm not sure it's for the same reasons, but it's becoming popular again today, right? 10 shekels of gold in the two bracelets. I mean, we see the advertisements, you know, that they went to such and such a place to get the diamond ring. What is the name of the place? Somebody yell out. You women know. What is it?
Jared.
They went to Jared's for the jewelry, whatever it is, right? Got the best, right? She got the best. She got two bracelets with 10 shekels of gold. That's probably somewhere in the hundreds of thousands of dollars of value in today's marketplace. What woman wouldn't go, whoo! Now here's a guy who can provide, right? And then he asks the question, whose daughter are you? He's asking a good question, isn't he? Whose daughter are you? How were you raised? What are your values? What has been instilled into you from birth? Whose daughter are you, right? What if somebody walked up to you today and said, whose daughter are you? What would your answer be? Maybe you'd give a long, drawn-out history of how that I'm so-and-so's daughter, but my mom and dad divorced, and then I'm now the stepdaughter, and you have this long drawn out story of a mixed identity of who you truly are, right? And that's exactly what's going on in our world today, isn't it? People have not a clue who they are. They don't know where they came from. They don't know their destiny. They don't know what God has called them forth to be, and they're confused in their identity, right? But the servant simply said, whose daughter are you? Jesus is asking his bride the same question. Whose daughter are you? Do you know who you are in Christ? Because if you don't know who you are in Christ, then you're confused. Amen? Because he's told you who you are. Amen? Mm-hmm. And that's what we need to listen to. Whose daughter are you? Tell me, please. And is there room in your father's house for us to lodge? It was the common question of that day and time, right? Because in the Mideast or in the Eastern countries, hospitality was a big deal, right? And so whose daughter are you, and is your family hospitable? Or are they selfish, right? Because if you got no room for me now, you ain't gonna have no room for me later, right? If you ain't got no room for me to be a part of your family, if you haven't got no room for me to be included as part of who you are, then you're not ever going to have any room for me, right? And And just like Jesus, there won't be no room in the inn for you. Amen? Good questions to ask. And so she, Rebecca, said to him, look at this, she knows. She doesn't go, well, you know, it's a long story. She goes, I am. Doesn't that sound like somebody knows who they are? I am the daughter of Bethuel, Milcah's son, whom she bore to Nahor. And moreover, she said to him, we have both straw and feed enough and room to lodge. You're welcome here. We got room for you. In fact, we were waiting for you to get here. We've had this extra room. We've had this extra food. We've had all of this thing stored away. We were planning for visitors. It's not a surprise. We were hoping for them. Right? Is that the way you live your lives? Are you hoping that you might have the opportunity to entertain a stranger unaware, thinking it might be an angel? That's what Scripture says, by the way, doesn't it? Right? In Hebrews 13:16, it says, do not neglect the good and share what you have, for with such sacrifices, they are pleasing to God. Amen? And in Galatians 6:10, so then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. When a missionary or a traveling preacher comes into the town, do we go, well, there's room down there at the Quality Inn? He goes, there ain't room at your house. You got no room for me. You got no room for me to stay in your house. You ain't got no room in your heart for the message God's given me to give to you. Right? If you got no hospitality in your reception, there's not going to be any hospitality in your heart to receive what God has prepared for you. Amen? Ouch, that hurts, doesn't it? Hebrews 13:2, do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained strangers, or angels unawares. 1 Timothy 3:2, therefore an overseer must be above reproach. The husband of one wife must be sober-minded, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, and able to teach. God has some pretty strict qualifications for those he's going to trust with his word and trust with his bride, doesn't he? He doesn't just give that responsibility to anyone, right? Point number two is pretty clear as well, if you like points. Thank God for leading you. You know, there's a story in the Bible about the 10 lepers, and Jesus healed all 10 of them. And only one came back with thanks in his heart and said, thank you, Lord. I want to know who you are. You healed me. You made me whole. And I don't just want to think, oh, woo, good, good. Thanks, Lord. I want to know who you are. I want to know a person who loved me that much that you'd die for me. I want to know the person who loved me so much that he would be patient with this stubborn fool and allow me to make so many mistakes that you should have crushed me. And yet you went, I love you. And I know your potential, even though you don't know it. And I know what I've called forth in you. And I want you to go forth and do that. Amen. Verse 26 says, and the man bowed down his head and he worshiped the Lord. He worshiped the Lord for hearing his prayer. And he said, blessed be the Lord God of my master Abraham, who has not forsaken his mercy and his truth towards my master. And as for me, being on the way, the Lord led me to the house of my master's brethren. Lord, thank you for leading me to the place where I needed to be. Thank you for bringing forth the person that you had chosen and then causing me to know that she was the one. How many people have done that? How many people said, Lord, thank you for making it sure to me that my bride is the one that you chose for me. My husband is the one that you chose for me. We are not unequally yoked together. You brought us together in an equal yoke of like-minded faith, and you have brought us to a place where we can be fruitful and we can multiply within your kingdom. Amen?
Amen.
That's what every marriage should be able to say. That's what the bride of Christ should be able to say about her husbandmen and the church that we belong to each and every day. Amen? 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. In Hebrews 13:15 it says, by him therefore let us offer up the sacrifice of praise to God continually, which is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. And in 1 Peter 2:9, but you, somebody look at somebody and say, you are a chosen generation. You're a royal priesthood and a holy nation. A peculiar people. Say to somebody, you're peculiar. Right? God's the one calling you peculiar, not me. Right? God says, you're a peculiar person. You got some peculiar characteristics about you. Right? That you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of the darkness and into his marvelous light. Isn't God telling us who we are right there? That's our identity. That's who we are. We can say, I am a chosen generation. I am a royal priesthood. I am a holy nation. Right? I am a peculiar people. And if you can't deal with that, then maybe you ought to get peculiar. Right? Have you ever prayed and asked God to show you who needs him? Have you ever got up in the morning and said, Lord, you know, I got all these things I got to get done today. If you're Jim, I got to go mow lawns. I got to go do some asphalt jobs. I got to go do this. I got to go do that. Whoever you are, you got your tasks you're going to do. I'm going to go make some duct tape wallets. I'm going to go out and do some ship shopping, all of that. Before you do any of that, have you ever said, Lord, in my travels today, help me to cross the path of someone who needs you. And then let my life be such a shining light and witness unto them that they'll stop momentarily and say, hey, who are you? What's different about you? There's something about you that's different. I don't know what it is, but something about you that's different. Can you tell me what it is? Because God will create them opportunities for you to be a witness for him if you'll pray and ask first. If we just go about our day as though we don't have any concern for the lost, God goes, okay. But if you would ask me, I'll bring somebody across your path who needs what you've got. And that has a story similar to yours that will hear your story. Amen? We got to be able to tell the story. In Acts 1:8, here's what he said. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and unto the ends of the earth. That's every day, folks. That isn't when I feel like it on Sundays. Every day, we are his witness. Amen? We're witnessing the fact that our husband is perfect. Man, you got to see the guy he gave me, right? You ever have women that are like, Jane, you ought to see my husband, right? He's something. Or the man who said, man, you ought to see my wife. She's something, right? Point number three in closing. We also need to discover who the family is. We've got 4 points, but I don't know if I'll ever get there. We're running out of time. So the young woman ran and told her mother's household these things. Now Rebekah had a brother whose name was Laban. And Laban ran out to the man by the well. And so it came to pass when he saw the nose ring and the bracelets on his sister's wrists, and when he heard the words of his sister Rebekah saying, thus the man spoke to me, that he went to the man. And there he stood by the camels at the well, and he said, come in, O blessed of the Lord. Be Beware of strangers with smiling faces. We don't even get to see it here too closely, but the very character of Laban's already being revealed. He's more interested on the 10-packed camels than he is upon anything else. This guy's rich. I think I could probably get me some of that. Right? But he goes on, and he puts on a little masquerade, because now he's just keeping with the Mideastern philosophy of hospitality, right? And he said, come on in, blessed of the Lord. Why do you stand outside? For I have prepared the house and a place for the camels. So the man came to the house, and he unloaded the camels and provided straw and feed for the camels and water to wash his feet and the feet of those who were with him, which was a common practice of that day. Remember when Jesus walked into the house and they didn't wash his feet? And a woman came and washed his feet with her hair and with her tears, because no one in the house had washed the feet of Jesus. Food was set before him to eat, but he said, I will not eat until I have told about my errand. And then he began to speak. Point number four, and we'll close it up real fast. Don't let anything distract you from your purpose, not even eating. A nice meal had been prepared. Man, it might have been steak and lobster, and I love steak and lobster. Hey. But he wasn't going to eat until he had told why, what his purpose of being there was. Because he needed the family's approval. He'd already kind of gotten Rebecca's approval, but he needs the family's approval. See, when we're dating, when we're looking for our prospective spouse, and we go and we meet the family for the first time, and the family is hostile to you, folks, that's a warning sign. It's a warning sign that the family's not ever going to accept you. And if the family's not ever going to accept you, sooner or later, the woman who's part of that family is going to have trouble accepting you. Amen? Or the man's going to have trouble accepting you. God shows us things, and we need to pay attention when he shows us these things. Amen? Because they're important for all time. So he said, I am Abraham's servant. The Lord has blessed my master greatly, and he has become great. And he has given him flocks and herds, silver and gold, male and female servants, and camels and donkeys. And Sarah, my master's wife, bore a son to my master when she was old, and to him he has given all that he has. There's the statement. The person who I'm here representing, my master's son Isaac, he's given him everything. Hasn't the Father given to Jesus everything? He gave him authority over all things in heaven and earth. He gave him authority over everything that he has. Everything that belongs to the Father belongs to Jesus, Jesus said. Amen? He's the richest one that there is. He owns the cattle on a thousand hills. Have you ever asked him to sell a couple of them to meet your need? Have you ever believed deep down in your heart what he said? I will meet your every need out of my glorious riches in Christ Jesus. When we have a need, do we plead what we need over his glorious riches that he promised to provide through? Or do we go, well, if the Lord so will? That's not faith. Call it forth. Amen. Call forth what belongs to you. Now my master made me swear, saying, you shall not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites in whose land I dwell, but you shall go to my father's house and to my family and take a wife for my son. And I said to my master, perhaps the woman will not follow me. But he said to me, the Lord before whom I walk will send his angel with you and prosper your way. And you shall take a wife for my son from my family and from my father's house. And you will be clear from this oath when you arrive among my family. For if they will not give her to you, then you are released from this oath. If the family will not give her to you joyfully and willingly, then leave. She's not the one. Amen? Oh, how our young people need to hear these words today. Amen? Our young people who are coming into marriageable age in the next few years need to hear this message. And they need to let this be how they look for a spouse as they come of age. Amen? And as parents, we need to make sure we've instilled these things into our children and into our grandchildren who are coming of age. Otherwise, they're going to choose according to their own flesh, and they're going to reap according to their own flesh. And if you live by the flesh, you will die. Amen? But if you will walk by the Spirit and trust in God to do what Abraham sent his servant to go do, then God will provide, God will bless, and you will be fruitful, and you will multiply within the kingdom of God. Amen? Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for your word. Every single one of us here today, Lord, take this message to heart. We've all got children. We've all got grandchildren. Help us to raise them up in the way that they should go, Lord, so that as they come of age, they will now depart from it and go and choose according to their flesh, but they instead will entrust their choosing to you, the only one who knows all things and the only one who is able to choose out the one who is right for us and that will cause our marriages and our lives to be filled with joy and with fruitfulness and multiplication for the honor and the glory of your name. And these things we ask in the name of Jesus. And everybody said,
Amen.
Amen.
I invite everybody to stand up for the closing song. And as always, if you feel led to give, the ways are appearing as on the behind you.
I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.